Hi.
Hi.
Let's see what I need to do to make myself. Are you going to make me a presenter?
I think you've just been made a presenter.
I just switched it over to you.
All right, great. Can you guys see my screen?
Yep.
Okay, great. I'm going to apologize in advance because I got a little overambitious in trying to put something together here, as is my wont. Hopefully I can still illustrate, maybe without the marketing panache, some of the new stuff that we've got for Vasari. Particularly what I'm really excited about is a new functionality called Repeat and Divide, which are actually sort of two somewhat separate functionalities, but they allow you to create lots of stuff in a fairly controlled way. So what I was hoping to go for was to get into a whole sort of louvering system workflow for a building. Kind of got away from me this morning, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you the basic building blocks of this kind of tool, how you can use it for doing form making, and what kind of stuff can come out of it. So over here what we've got is I have what I guess you could say is a reasonably complicated array of similar elements that have a relationship between two lines. Again, this is a tool that is available also in Revit 2013. Brought it over into Vasari because it's useful for early stage design, just for sort of conceptualizing form, as well as for making sort of finished elements. What I want to do is I'm going to dissect this element over here a little bit, just to sort of show you how you can enter into using this kind of tool. So this is an in-place mask like we are used to. I'm going to edit that in-place mask. And we can see I've got an element here that is called a repeater. The repeater has a type. It's made out of adaptive columns, which is a loaded family. And so I'm going to try and build this thing back up from pieces to show you how this goes together. So I'm going to delete that guy. And I'm going to show you that underneath it, there are these two elements, which are called divided paths. Divided path is fairly similar to another functionality that we've had for a while called divided surface, as you might expect. What it does instead of dividing a whole surface is it just divides any particular line that you have. So again, I'm going to keep deleting to get back to sort of atomic elements. All right, so I've got two lines in space here, right? And these are made in the sort of standard drawing workflow where you're drawing lines and you can pick points, drag them around, get your cool shape, what have you. So if I pick this line and this line, I can pick them one at a time, it doesn't really matter. You can see there's a tool that's available now that was not available to you in 2012 called Divided Path. Now, I hit it, big deal. I get some node points on these lines. Those little nodal points are the indication of where you're going to want to put other geometry. And that other geometry is going to be adaptive components. It has similar properties to things like divided surface. You know, if I go in here, I can change the number of nodes that appear on here. I can change how they're spaced. It can be by distance or by, you know, I want X number of them, or I have a maximum spacing. I'm just going to leave them as it is for now at fixed distance. And I'm going to show you a little bit about how you now put stuff on it. So over here, I have an adaptive component. And actually, before I even do that, I'm just going to go even simpler here. I'm going to make a new one from scratch. So if I go into my V menu, I can go New Family, and I can choose an adaptive component, same as we had them before. And I'll just make a relatively simple piece of geometry. Say I've got, I'm going to make a point, because adaptive components love points, and they thrive on them. If I make it adaptive, now I've got an adaptive point. And if I make two of them, do another adaptive point. I have two of them. They're numbered, 1 and 2. See, this is point number 2. I don't know if you can see that on your screens. This is point number 1. And what that indicates is the order in which I'm going to place these points down. And I'm going to do a really dumb and simple one. It's just going to be a line. So I've got a line with points 1 and 2. I'm going to load it back into my project. And I've got it here in my tooltip. Like any other family does, when you load it in, it becomes the active tool. You'll also see it's now over here under generic model. You can change generic model into a couple other things, but let's just keep this generic model for now. So I can take my adaptive component of 2 points, and I can, in an unexciting way, just place down lines. So they look like lines, but they're in fact loaded families. So you can do the same parametric substitution that you might want on anything else. So if I select this guy, and I'll see that I can substitute it out for my adaptive column, which is just another one that I have loaded in here. Basic family behavior, folks are familiar with. So if I take this guy, I'm just going to rehost this one, pick new host here. And I'm going to host it on a couple of these node points. See, it just snaps to that node, snap and snap, like that. So big deal once again. Well, if I pick that line, you know the old array tool up here? Well, there's a sort of subtle indication that you've got something different here. You've got a little P on it indicating that this is a patterning tool. It's a repeating tool, and you'll see that it comes up with a different set of tooltips. So if I repeat this thing, when I select that and hit it, it's going to repeat that same family over both of these two lines spanning the distance. And if I go and I change the number of layout, for instance, to 12, you see that I'll now have more elements. I just really beef it up. And then again, with any other sort of parametric substitution, you can sub in a different family. So here I've got a family that is another two-pick component, and I've built in a little logic to it so that basically as it gets longer, it gets bigger. I've got some other tutorials on the BuildZ site about how to do that kind of work. And if we want to, later on at the end, I can show a little bit more about how to make a family like this that just has this kind of simple intelligence built into it. Well, if I take this guy, I can, like with anything else, I can choose a different family to substitute it in. So if I put in this component that has a little bit more intelligence to it, now I've got an element that gets bigger and fatter the longer it gets. And so, of course, as with most other things, new bones connected to the hip bone. If I go and I pull this guy, the change percolates through the line, percolates through the divided surface, percolates through the elements that are hosted on it. And in this way, you know, you can start building up some interesting forms. You can make decisions about how much resolution you're going to have on this. Here I'm picking the divided surfaces again, saying that I want to make this, you know, a denser arrangement of these pieces, what have you, that sort of thing. So we can get more into this, and we can explore some of the stuff that's going on in this if we have time, but I want to make sure that we have time to cover everything else first. This louvering system over here, just so you know what it's doing, is using the same principles of the adaptive component to actually make a louvering system which adjusts itself based on its orientation. This one is doing big, fat, long louvers in the south where there might be more sun coming in, and smaller up to the north. And again, this is something that's done without scripting, but through sort of just drawing methods. So without too much more on this, and again, we can come back to this if people are interested, I wanted to just show you a couple of the things that we've added for visualization. Primarily, one of the exciting things that we've got going on, if you go up into the Manage tab, you're going to see a new button for Render in Cloud. So again, this is a Autodesk 360 enabled tool where, rather than using your own CPU or graphics card to do complex renderings, what is happening with this tool is that you're packaging up your geometry and your lighting information and your material information that lives on your computer, packaging up and sending up to a cloud server that's going to go and do the rendering for you. And then you have the ability to then go and visualize these, to see these renderings up on the cloud, providing that you've signed in. So here is just a rendering that I've done earlier of this same geometry. And let me just take a look at this guy. So here it is. Again, I apologize for not having more interesting renderings, but I got distracted by this geometry over here. So just to show you how you start to get into that, same as with any other rendering, I'm gonna go to a plan view for a second here, and I'm going to make myself a camera. I recommend using a camera view rather than using the working perspective view, partly because the working perspective view is not cropped. That is, it extends in all directions, and renderings don't like that. If you use a camera view and you go and put it in here, you're going to have a cropped view, which is, you know, more amenable to doing rendering visualizations and static views. So basic, usual camera behavior. I haven't, again, put in more complex materials for this, but you can just sort of see how I can take my basic geometry and I just go make sure that I'm signed in so that it knows what account to send it to. And for lab users, there's a 75 cloud units, which basically breaks down to about 15 renderings. For subscription users, there's an unlimited number of renderings that you can do right now. So if I go to render in cloud, I'm going to get some basic instructions about what I'm doing. I'm going to send up the rendering. Surface is going to notify me when it's ready, and then I can go and look on the rendering gallery on the cloud in order to take a look at what's happened. So if I continue, I basically have a choice of sending any number of renderings up at once, so I can do a whole set of my views rather than just doing one at a time, if that's what I'm into. The output type, there's a panoramic image, which is pretty interesting. I haven't played around with it as much as I probably should, but I encourage you to. And then some other sort of standard kinds of interactions. What kind of quality do you want? Draft, standard, high, best. Of course, draft is going to process faster than a best is going to, and you're going to have a difference in what your output is there. Image size, fairly self-explanatory. How big do you want your image to be? Here, it's only giving me one dimension of control because I have multiple renderings selected that have different aspect ratios. If I go and I just do a single view, like the one that I have right now, I'll be able to more finely control or see what my output's going to be. Native exposure takes the exposure settings that you have set up in your view. Advanced uses a cloud-based system to actually try and optimize and find the best exposure for the particular view that you're setting. And of course, you can send different kinds of file formats. So I'm going to start rendering it, and I'm just going to decide that I don't want to sit here and watch this thing spin. So I'm going to close that out. And then, again, I can go and go to the cloud, and here I can see my previously rendered image. I can have certain manipulations on it, download it, use it for other things, adjust the exposure. It keeps exposure settings, so you can make some changes, which is a nice sort of amenity also.
One question that came in was, does the cloud rendering material match the Revit rendering material?
Yes, it does. And again, if I had sort of watched the clock this morning, I would have been putting on some things like bricks and textures and that sort of thing. But yes, it does. I've noticed a few quirks in scaling in particular. There are a couple of materials that I've seen, like I've sent up grass, and the density of the grass is a little bit different on the cloud rendering. For sort of under the hood what's going on, when you do a local rendering, it's using the Mental Ray rendering engine, which is a little bit different than the rendering engine that they're using on the cloud. And so there are differences. You're not going to see a pixel-to-pixel identical nature to the renderings that you do locally versus the ones that you do on the cloud. But in terms of what you can do locally while I'm waiting for that cloud rendering to get going up there, one other thing that y'all might have noticed in your last download of Vasari is that it got a little chunkier, a little thicker in the middle. The download now is about 800 megabytes. Part of that is because we've included the full rendering library now with the beta release. And just to sort of show you what that means, if you don't have another Autodesk Hero application installed, like Revit or AutoCAD or 3D Studio Max, if you go to the Manage tab, you're going to see in your Materials browser that you've actually now got the full rendering editor. It's the one difference between this and if you have another Hero application installed is that we don't ship with the full AEC material library, and some of our image maps are a little bit smaller than the ones that come with the full product, just because it makes the file size sort of bloat a little bit. But again, you can still make all of your own custom materials, and you can edit them, and you can paint them onto elements here in the screen. So if you go to modify, paint, you can go through and make your different materials here. And you can see the live textures here in the viewport. And again, these are sort of some silly materials that I'm going to paint onto here, but you can get the idea of different kinds of available materials if you do want to go in and invest some time in making your rendering sing with the materials that are appropriate to them. So again, we can come back to some of this stuff if we still have time, but I did want to just point out a couple things of the online rendering and the divided surface and sort of more intelligent arrays that are available. There's a whole world to explore in really both of these features, including also the local rendering. Just one other thing to sort of mention about how you access the local rendering tools. Sorry, this is a little rambling. I'm going to go back to my camera view. Where's my camera view? Here it is. You'll see down here at the bottom, you've got the little teapot. And there's a keyboard shortcut, RR, will also bring up the rendering menu where you can actually kick off the renderings. This is, again, a tool that was present if you had other Hero applications installed previously with Vasari, but now you can put Vasari on a completely naked machine that has nothing else on it, and you'll be able to access these functionalities so you can render right on just about any machine that you put it on. So. With that, I'm going to turn it over to
Hey, Zach, one more question.
To talk a little bit about beta. Yep, sure.
Just one more question while we're on this topic. How is the cloud renderer different from the 3D Max renderer, and what is the cloud rendering engine?
The 3D Max renderer, I'm not as familiar with the 3D Max renderer, except that there's a lot of different renderings that you can have, rendering engines that you can use with 3D Studio Max. It does have, 3D Studio Max does have built into it the Mental Ray rendering tools. Mental Ray, that is the local rendering that you do on Revit and local rendering that you can do on Max, are in fact the same rendering tool. You should get really nearly identical renderings from the Max version and the local Revit rendering version. The one on the cloud is a different technology. It has very much the same feature set in terms of how it handles things like global illumination, accurate lighting levels and that sort of thing. When you set, you're not going to have a pixel per pixel identical rendering from either the Max local renderings or the cloud and the cloud renderings, but you'll have pretty similar outputs. I don't know if that answers the question. But.
Yeah, that's great. One more important question to address here is: are the performance characteristics of material properties included so that the energy analysis tool can take this into account?
No, rendering materials do not affect what the energy analysis is. It might be worth, if anybody else on the call is comfortable talking about it, talking about the concept of physical materials, because that is probably something that will be of interest to people. I'm not sure that I would want to talk to it unless anybody else, Lily or Matt, can speak to that.
It's not applicable for the conceptual model right now. So it doesn't have an effect right now. It's right. Somewhere where we're looking at and hope to go in the future.
The other thing about if people are interested in the interaction with these models with Max, the recommended way to go from a Revit model into Max to preserve your rendering settings is with an FBX export, which is also available on Vasari. So you can set up your views, you can do preliminary renderings as you like them in Vasari. You can export them to FBX, bring them into Max, and pretty much have them ready to go, whether you're going to want to do large-scale renderings, batch renderings, using local servers to do server farms, that sort of thing.
Great. Thanks, Zach. Let's move on to Matt just to make sure that we give him enough time, and then we'll come back and address some more of these questions at the end.
Great.